So it may be time for a critical rhetoric of critical rhetoric. It may be time to actually provoke us to think differently about the whole notion of critical rhetoric. For me, critical rhetoric is very much an orientation. It's a way of asking questions about the present. And it's a deeper set of questions than just why is something happening, because it really looks at the underlying relationships of power and knowledge, and asks questions about who gets to say something with authority, what it means for that person to have authority, and asking questions not just so that we know, but asking questions so that we have opportunities to think about those relationships differently. So in my read and my fabulous co-author, Brandon Daniels, what we noted was when Maccaro's conception emerges, of course the first question almost everyone asks is, but how can you do politics that way? Because that's not the way we do politics. We do politics by being advocates. And so ideological critics like my colleague Dana Cloud came after critical rhetoric and said, this is ultimately going to not only be ineffective, but will kind of perpetuate broader structures of ideology because of it being so ineffective. You'll actually end up masking the same relationships of domination you were meant to unmask. So that led to, I think, a little bit of a crisis. And in our reading of the development of critical rhetoric, the next sort of major step is by Kent Ono and John Sloop. They make the argument that broader society, the bigger formations of discourse, have a notion of judgment and justice, which they would call in-law discourse. Not like your in-laws, but in-law, within the legal structure. And then they advocated that critics should go not to the broader public sphere, which is part of this in-law discourse, but we should go to the margins to look for communities, vernacular discourses from communities that are outlaws, with the hopes that by introducing that different discourse into the broader conversation, we could be disruptive. What Brandon and I found interesting was how much that changes that orientation. So for Maccaro, the critic was, to some extent, somewhat disembodied, provocateur, reading culture against the grain. By the time we get to the more recent participatory critical rhetoric, we have recentered the critic as being the center of meaning within the critical act. Now for us, again, we're not saying participatory critical rhetoric has blasphemed the gospel of critical rhetoric. Nor are we trying to say, look, how evolutionary movement has made this progressive. For us, our approach to looking at the history of critical rhetoric is very Foucauldian. There was this idea. It emerged within the discourse of rhetorical studies. It was called critical rhetoric. Then there were some seismic shifts that moved it, and other shifts that moved it, and other shifts that moved it. So our focus is less on trying to create a continuity and much more on trying to say, look at how much it's shifted. So if you really read critical participatory rhetoric against the 1989 critical rhetoric essay, there's a lot of resemblance, but to us, there's a very telling points of discontinuity that I think shed light on the deeper question of what we mean when we talk about doing criticism.